Hello, friend.
Hello, hello, how are you?
Good. How are you? How's your day?
I'm good. How are you? Everything
Good.
okay?
Yeah, long day.
Long day,
Zoom
yeah?
meetings after another Zoom meeting.
Are you hearing me from this mic or from this mic?
I'm
One,
hearing you
two.
from
One,
the
two.
microphone, I think, on
From
your phone.
my phone, right? I don't think
Yeah.
this thing's working. Okay, never
No.
mind. We'll just have to use without it.
I hear you perfectly.
Okay.
Can you hear me perfectly? I don't know if the sound's good.
Yeah, it is. Let me see if I
Okay,
can.
fortunate.
Never mind lah. You can hear me, I can hear you. That's what's important.
Yeah, that's important. Well, you being more professional than I
No.
Yeah.
Hello,
So, was it a long day for you today?
yep, running around, had a couple of meetings today, but all good meetings, had a great lunch, then an afternoon recording, and then had dinner, meatball, and then I'm here, and then I got another meeting at 9-ish, but
Okay.
it's a good day. How about you? What have you been up to today?
Same thing. Meetings. I mean, I'm in college, second year
Okay.
in Hillsong College, and so I have classes in the morning. Then I yeah, meetings, ministry sessions and stuff. So, and then preparing for this tonight. So yeah, I know it's gonna be a casual conversation, but of course I still have to prepare.
Now, I'm ready. Anything, everything, let's go.
All right. So I'm
Okay.
just gonna put you before we go to like the grilling, I'm just gonna put you in the hot seat for a
Okay.
minute. So
Okay.
I don't know how many questions we'll get through in a minute, but anyway, I don't have time countdown, so we'll just go for it. If there is a movie about you, who would play you?
There's a movie about me, who would play me? Huh? Oh, who would play me?
Yeah.
That's such a strange question. I've never thought about that. Who would play me? Who would play me? I
Tom
don't know.
Cruise. Who?
Tom Cruise, because he's really short.
No, he's one of the A-list. I think he. I mean, he's good looking. He's A-list. Who? I don't know. I'm just thinking on top of my mind. Chris Hemsworth.
Okay, I think Chris Hemsworth would best represent me.
Okay, we'll take that. All right. If you're doing ministry and social work. If you're not doing ministry and social work, what's your dream job?
Okay. Two things. Number one, I wouldn't mind being a barista, a Starbucks barista, because I feel like all I need to be concerned about is that I kind of like did the whipped cream right. I got the name right. I got the coffee right. I don't want to deal with anything else. I don't want to be promoted. All you can fault me for is whether I did the coffee right and the whipped cream. So that's to me, it's not as like I don't want to think so much. And then the other thing would be zookeeper. I would love,
Zookeeper, really?
absolutely, absolutely. I think I have a heart for shepherding. So if I was not in ministry and all that, I would still love to shepherd animals, and then they can't really hurt you.
Yeah, that's kind of true. All right, next question. Instrument or voice?
Instrument or voice? Voice. Voice, 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 voice.
Yeah.
I can't imagine not singing. I can't
I
imagine. How
feel
about
you.
you?
I feel you. I feel
Instrument or
you.
voice?
For me,
Yeah.
definitely voice. I thought
Okay.
about this question a long time. So, voice. All
Okay, very nice.
right. Okay, this is a fashion question because I love fashion. I think you like fashion too.
Okay.
Fear of God or Off-White?
Fear of God, 100% done.
Okay, why? Why? Okay, just give like maybe a
Because it's the
reason.
word God in it. No, I just love the colors. I love the style a little bit more. Off-White, I don't really get it. I used to make fun of. I have a friend who has an Off-White jacket, and then he has the huge tag behind him. And I get it, it's a style and a statement, but it's just fun playing around with that. But yeah, fear of God for sure, 100%.
Nice. All right, so that's the question for the hot seat. Okay, so 2013, that's how we met. that's like 7 years ago in the final one. And tonight, the purpose of this conversation, the purpose of this conversation is about, I have a vision and it's about calling. And yeah. So how did music start for you?
Yeah. Well, I think for me, I always loved and enjoyed music. I was always involved in it in one way or another, but I wasn't really involved in like singing or any of that. In fact, when I was in church, I was not serving on any music or worship team. But I remember at 14 years or 15 years old, I just thought, hey, I don't mind serving something in my church. And I remember at that point in time, a person approached me and says, hey, would you want to learn drums? So I went, oh, okay, I'll take that as like a sign from God. And so I decided, okay, I'll go and play drums. And so the person taught me how to play drums. About a month or a few months later, he kind of left church. So I was left alone playing drums and I was not ready for it. But I just played, you know, simple beats. I played for the worship team. And then I started to play every single week. Every single week I was playing the drums, I was worshiping. And then I kept doing that. And then only about 21, 22, then I really began to like, okay, what if I do worship leading and singing? Because at that point in time, there was a need for that. So I went to do that. And then that's how I kind of just fell into music per se. I've always loved it, always enjoyed it, but just never thought like, okay, I'm going to be a singer one day. Okay, I'm going to be a drummer one day. But yeah, the opportunity came by and I went, okay, let's go and do it. Yeah.
That's awesome. Like, so in a sense, you stumbled upon this pathway that you're in right now.
Yeah, I stumbled, but the Lord had always had the intention. I just didn't know that it was part of the path.
Yeah, 100%. That's so awesome. So we talk about music and then you move on to like a greater scale in terms of like media, and you you shared with me the other day about like the Raw Asia, mm-hmm. and you know, like the media dream. Mm-hmm. So it's how do I say it? It's hard to put it across. So is that part of your ministry now? Like, is media and ministry together, or it's a whole separate thing?
Yeah. I think for me, I don't know how to draw the lines. I don't know what is ministry and what's not ministry. And by ministry, I'm just saying like whatever that's unto the Lord. So maybe when I was younger, it was easier to define. This is like my church life, and then this is my secular life. And then after that, as you grow up, you realize, wait, there is no separate life. Everything, right? Because the worship that He desires from us is not a role or a roster, right? Reasonable worship is this, that your life is a living sacrifice. So for me, I just go, anything that I find my hands to do, that is my worship and ministry. That's why when I did The Voice or when we did the final one and all these different things, I didn't see that as separate from the worship team. I felt like when I got on stage, it was a worship unto God. It was a worship unto Him. And so therefore, even in the song choices, like when I was in final one, I was very selective of my song choices because it was anything that I felt like I couldn't sing it unto the Lord. I just wouldn't do it. And I got into trouble multiple times when they wanted me to sing songs about like how I like young girls. And right. I said, no, they're like, we're not happy with you. But so to me, the music thing and the media thing is the ministry unto the Lord. At the end of the day, our calling and our goal is to point people towards Him. And so that doesn't change no matter the industry or the position, the place we're in. Yeah. For
that's
me.
Awesome. That's really awesome because like, I think there is a certain pressure in the media industry. We both know that, you know, in order to do, in order to progress, to get promoted, to be elevated, we need to adhere to certain standards of the world. And so you brought up an important point or a question that I can tackle is that, so now being in the, like, you know, being the media industry or having that experience, how do you stand firm on what you believe and like in a sense defend like what you know, like what is attacking your principle?
Yeah. You know, I feel like I've been given it easy, meaning that for a long time, the Lord didn't open a door for me to go into the media industry. Right. And so when I was from 14 all the way to 28, and that's about 14 years, when the doors were not open, I always thought God was against me. I always thought He was not for my dreams. He was not for me. But what the 14 years of waiting and painful rejection did for me is that it allowed me to build my identity firmly in the Word. So that eventually when 27 and 28, the doors opened, I knew who I was as a person. Because as we go about our industry, whether it's the media, whether it's the workplace, whether it's a school, camp, in relationships or friendships, if we don't know who we are and we are just motivated by the right and the wrong, I can't do this because as a Christian, I shouldn't do it. How long will that take you? How long can that drive you? How long would the law keep you? You know, and it's going beyond what's right and wrong, but saying this is my truth. And so when you're younger, or as a younger Christian, we always go, oh yeah, this is the Christian thing to do. This is a not Christian thing to do. And we find this wrestle because sometimes the conviction hasn't arrived. But in fact, we're not to dilute the right and wrong. In fact, we're going to go a step deeper to go, wait, live by the truth that you've claimed to be a truth. And so when I go into the media sphere or when I go into different spaces, I ask myself this question, Isaac, what is your truth? And then I make those decisions. So I'm before a person and the right and wrong can be very great. And then I ask myself, Isaac, what is the truth of the Lord in your life? And then I make those decisions. So I think I paid the price in the 14 years thinking that the Lord was rejecting me, but He was putting me through the fire to refine me. So that when I got into the industry, I went, you know what? Lose, win, you don't like me, you like me, you think I'm a loser for not singing a song about women. I don't care. So at the end of the day, I know what's my goal and my prize.
Yeah.
And so if anybody is listening and you feel like you're in a waiting season, you feel like your calling or the dream or the thing that God has put in your heart seems to be going nowhere and you feel abandoned, I want you to know the Lord is such a good God. Hebrews says, right, He disciplines those He loves. If we are His children, He disciplines. And the word discipline is not whoosh. The whole chapter says He strengthens our feeble arms and our feet. And the Lord is strengthening you for the moment that He's calling you into. So be patient. And if you be patient and it never comes to it and you die, guess what? The first thing you're going to see is Jesus. And that is a glorious moment.
Yeah. Yes, that's awesome. Really. I think you touch on identity, and that's something that a lot of youths, they struggle these days, you know, like finding their identity on social media and like, oh, you know, now we live in an instant gratification generation where, you know, at the moment we post something online on story or our feed, we get the instant like and validation. Yes. So 14 years of training and being in a dark room and, you know, like God honing that, not just honing, but God strengthening your identity. What did you do in that 14 years and how did God strengthen your identity to get you to where you are supposed to be today?
So multiple C's. The first C is crying. Lots of crying. Let's be honest. When we're going through a valley, it's not going to be like, oh, hallelujah. You know, a lot of crying. You feel like you've been abandoned. You feel like things are not fair. And so you cry, and I cry a lot. And in these little low valley moments, that's where I really build my intimacy with the Lord. You know, I really find my space. And so that's the first thing, being able to process, because my flesh is weak, my emotions and my soul is weak. And so it's a lot of crying, a lot of wondering. The other C is the Lord begins to disciple and begins to refine me by dealing with the ugly C called comparison. Because then at the 14 years, you look at other people making their mark. You look at other people succeeding. You look at other people being able to do what they've been called to do in whatever industry and field. And you go, what about me? Well, what have I done wrong? And comparison is such an ugly fruit of a deeper insecurity and identity. And if you struggle with comparison, you hate that about yourself, give it time. It says, Lord, I lay at your feet. And so the Lord was molding me and discipling me through the 14 years. And so I cried, I compared, and in the comparison, the Lord dealt with my heart, says, Isaac, this is not what you're supposed to do. Another C is confidence. But what did I take confidence in? Did I take confidence in opportunity? Did I take confidence in viewership? Did I take confidence in people being able to validate me, therefore then I validate myself? And I think it was a moment of really deep humbling. And it was not just this like wild crying and just hanging on a moment to be able to finally get out of it. And so you say, Isaac, Would you say that your 27, 28 was your breakthrough moment? I would never say that. I would never say 27, 28 was my breakthrough moment because I was not wait, like in my soul, I was waiting for that. But the Lord gave me my breakthrough way more than that in the 14 years of breakthrough in my security, breakthrough in my confidence, breakthrough in my wholeness, breakthrough in my intimacy with Him. And so 27, 28, I always say it's an opportunity. The opportunity finally came. An opportunity to step into the assignment. But the breakthrough was the 14 years completely. And the breakthrough is that every single day, I just hung on to Him and He opened the eyes of my heart. And that is truly the breakthrough.
Wow. Yeah. So, on an honest scale, I don't know, would you want to go through that 14 years again?
So that's a hard one. I don't wish it upon anybody because of what it does to your flesh. But for what it did to my spirit, and then also the killing of my flesh, I feel like in hindsight, if I could do it all over again, and I've laid out all the options, I would say yes. Because what good is it if a man gain the whole world but lose his own soul? And I felt like the 14 years was a discovering of my soul and my spirit. And there's a lot of good and gain in that. Yeah. But I will cry. I will not skip through it. I'll be a mess. Yeah.
I think that is inevitable, and yeah, a lot of crying,
a lot of crying
on your knees, and like, God, where are you? How long more? Okay, you shared something about you rejected an opportunity. Would you want to share on that? Like, what was it very precious to you? Can we talk about that?
Which opportunity? Am I lagging?
I think a little bit.
Okay, one second.
No. I think maybe I'm lagging too.
Okay, am I around still?
Yeah, you're around.
Okay, hopefully this is better. Is this better?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not blur, am I?
No, you're perfectly clear.
Okay. Clear. Okay, so what? Which one? I've been rejected so many times.
No,
you guys tell me which rejection.
Oh. The one in Taiwan. Can you share about that?
Okay, Ken.
Is that before before you were 28?
No, that's after.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, I think that's a very good good question to tackle. So you shared that you rejected an opportunity which would have also, I think, would have promoted you and brought you further in your media, I don't know, like industry. Yeah, so what, do you want to just share, like, how do you feel, like, when we heard from God, like, oh, no, this is not for you, like, I have something better, the process, yeah.
Well, so, when I finished The Voice, I went to Taiwan, and we were in Taiwan doing some recordings and all that, and I was offered a contract to be a Taiwanese artist for 2 years, and so that was a really great deal in terms of the ability to growth in your career and growth in, becoming an artist and doing music and doing it full on. And so I was like, oh, wow, that's incredible. 2 years in Taiwan, be able to produce some music, get paid in Taiwan, somehow, walao, it's shiok, where there's cold weather, because I love cold weather. So even if they didn't offer me a contract, even if they said, we'll pay you to stay in Taiwan to enjoy the cold weather, I'll be like, I'm done. I'll go for it. But anyway, so they offered the contract. But when I prayed, I felt the Lord said, no, Isaac, I want you to come back to Singapore. And so I said, Lord, what do you want me to come back to Singapore to do? And I felt Him saying that, when you come back to Singapore for the next 2 years, I want you to give time to speak into youth, into lives of the young people, to go into youth ministries and churches. And so I went, but who's going to call me? Because I'm not a pastor. I didn't go to Bible school. At that point in time, I had an eyebrow piercing. And so I was like, nobody's really going to care. But I really felt it really strong from the Lord. So I said, okay, if that's what you're calling me to do, then that's what I'm going to do. So I turned down the offer and I came back to Singapore, yet without any real invitation. There was like one or two churches that wanted to invite me to speak. But then when I came back to Singapore, just a lot of churches and different ministries began to call and says, hey, we would like you come and speak. And the Lord just really orchestrated that. So in 2018 and 2019, I just did that. I went to youth ministries and to churches to share about the journey, to share about intimacy with the Lord, to share about Him coming after the hearts of people. And that's what I did. So that was an opportunity turned down. In terms of a secular world, it may seem like such a huge loss. But we know that, like, where we want to be is where the presence of the Lord is, right? Like Moses said, you can give me all the winds, right? You can give me all the glory, but if your presence is not there, and presence, we're not talking about goosebumps, right? Presence, we're talking about the face of the Lord. If your pleasure and your delight and your face is not there, then that's not where I want to go. And so for me, I was like, okay, if this is where you're at, this is where I want to go. And that's kind of the turn of the opportunity. Yeah.
So good. But did you cry over it? Like, oh, God.
Of course. I think also at that point in time, this was past 28. And so I had a little bit more confidence already, just going like, you know, God, if you say this is the way, I'm just going to go, you know. But it wasn't an easy choice, but it was not as paralyzing as before. As you continue to say yes, sometimes the yeses will be a bit easy, easier to agree with, because you've seen the goodness of the Lord and the remembrance of what He has done in the past will help you to make and continue to keep your eyes fixed on Him. Yeah.
Yes, that's so good. Yeah, I think, you know, sometimes we're not able to see what God has in store for us. And so amazing that the moment you said no, God had the right God opportunity for you when you came back to Singapore. So you mentioned about, like, oh, I'm not a pastor, I'm not I don't have a title per se. So how do you minister from that position and that place? Because, you know, like how some Christians out there, you know, like, for example, I'm not a pastor, but I've been invited to churches and to lead worship and actually preach and share, but I know I'm not a pastor and I don't think I want to be a pastor. And so, like, some people just disagree with, like, oh, you, who are you? You don't even have a title, but how come, what, why are you saying you're a minister, you're a full-time minister, you're in ministry? So for you, when you know that you don't have a title, I think I just want to, you know, like, ask that question, because I think there are people out there that will be asking, like, I'm nobody. How can I be in ministry? You know, like, what can I do for God? You know, like, there is no, position, no platform, no opportunity. But you know what? When we know our identity, when we don't need a title, which Jesus didn't have a title, right, to preach and minister to people, he was all ready to do miracles, to you know, heal the sick, to share about the kingdom of God. And so for you, what's your take on, like, not having a title, but yet, you know, you're still serving in full capacity in campus ministry and whatever you're called to do in this season?
You know, I feel like if the Lord calls you, he'll equip you. And when I say if the Lord calls you, I want to tell you that everybody has been called. You read the Bible and it's clear as day. We are called to go, to preach, to bring the good news, the great commission, to heal the sick, to help the poor, to heal the broken, to clothe, to feed. The call and the commission is endless. And I think we need to be real with ourselves to some degree when we try to belittle or give ourselves excuse that we can't do it because we are not given the title. I think I'm seeing that less and less now, more days. You know, I think in the past, those are things that are incredibly, like, are going to be something you need to adopt to be able to do. But I don't think that's the case anymore, not because the Bible has changed. The Bible has never changed. But I think people are becoming more aware that, look, my saying yes to the Lord is not me attending service once a week. That's not faith. That's not our Christian faith, to just attend service once a week. What does it mean to live every single day? And so we are called to be full times, right? Priests, right? We're called to be full times, like kings, right? Into the industries, into the different spaces, into wherever it may be. And I think that that's an important recognition first, before anybody says anything, it has to start with us. Because we can say, oh, somebody said about it, so I feel a little bit bad, I feel like insecure about it. But it's really going to be us that needs to believe it first. And then you see in the us a lot to open those doors. You know, when I went around the 2 years, I was very conscious to always tell people, hey, I'm not a pastor, by the way. And most of them didn't care. A lot of the senior pastors like, no, it's okay. We believe that the Lord's calling and put his hand upon you with what you like to speak. You know, and I think those things are important, just to be able to understand that you don't need to function in a label title per se, but with the life and with the things that God has placed in your hand, how can you bring glory to Him, right? Matthew says this, who puts a light under a bowl, who puts a bowl on a lamp, right? You don't do that. And so whatever that the Lord has put in your heart, whatever the Lord has gifted you in, whatever the Lord has blessed you with, how do you do that to point towards the Lord? Of course, when we talk about maybe being a pastor and all these things, perhaps it's not so much the label as it is being, you know, taken care of, being in a healthy community, being covered, having done a proper discipleship. And so then make sure those things are being settled in terms of covering, in terms of discipleship, all these different things. But otherwise, don't let the lack of a label prevent you from doing the thing that the Lord has called you out to do. Ephesians, right? For you are God's masterpiece, called to do a good work that you should walk in them. And it's so important that we walk in the good work that we're called to and run the race that He has called us to run.
Yeah. So good. So good. Yeah. I think you're right. You know, like, this is a generation that doesn't actually require labels anymore, because we are to take the Great Commission out there. And we are the church. We're not a building, but God has called us, you know, the church, because we are the church without the four walls. And it's us that will be going out into the marketplace, into, you know, wherever, the four corners of the world, you know, God can actually uproot you and put you in New York City or maybe in the most rural place. And you know, like, He will use you when you say, yes, Lord. And so, yeah, that's amazing. And I think, you know, like, just wanting to be more real here about, like, you know, the process, not just about the waiting, but, like, even from then to now, like, from the waiting, the preparation, and what you're doing now, have you ever thought of giving up?
I just thought of giving up yesterday.
It's a real place.
It's real. It's real. I think there are a lot of times we have these questions, right? Is it worth it? What's the point? What's the point of all that I'm doing? Should I give up, right? And I think a lot of times, the best way to tackle these questions are actually to finish these questions and actually answer them. A lot of times you go, is it worth it? Is it worth it? But you're not really asking the question. You're really actually just whining and complaining. And so I feel like it's important to ask yourself, is it worth it? Is it worth it? And to pursue down that train of thought, you know, does it mean, like, is all that I'm doing really amount to anything? What's the point? And to really ask that question. And every time we are in a very low moment of giving up, right?
Yeah.
Cry, right? Make it real. You don't have to, like, okay, bury it. But I think in those really low points, in the valley moments, it's an opportunity to build an altar. An altar of intimacy. And it's just like, you know what, Lord? I'm climbing back on the altar and I give my life to You. You know, and you can take your time with it. You know, sometimes I feel bad if I feel like I'm in a valley moment and I'm there for too long. And I think we need to be real with ourselves, of course, when we're there for too long. Because some people love to be in that place, right? They love to be in the depressed mode because it's rather addictive, right? Sadness is an addiction, right? It's a strange addiction. We're kind of like, right? And we mope in it. But I think at some point you need to catch yourself and say, I need to get out of it, you know? And I think be in it, be real with yourself, but at some point know where to go. I think it's time for me to move out of this place and really ask myself, why am I doing what I'm doing? Where am I going? And to really dare to build your space and your life in intimacy. And so I have many, 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 many of those moments when I look at my bank account, I go, I just want to give up. When I look at somebody that walked away, I go, I just want to give up. When I look at somebody that disappointed or discouraged me, I go, I just want to give up. When I look at my friends doing things that are, like, secular, like, they have made it, and I go, I really want to give up. When I hear another bad news, I really want to give up. When I'm tired, I really want to give up. But the one thing that really keeps me is His presence. So it's not just to throw myself more work. It's not just to say, Isaac, suck it up. You know, you just get on with it. Maybe there are seasons where people need to do that, but that can only last for so long. And so I always need to come back to my center and my anchor point, that which is Jesus. You know, just go, Lord, help me to keep on. But yes, giving up is very, very, very real.
I think it's part and parcel of life. And so you kept mentioning, and when you were answering this question about giving up mm-hmm. intimacy. So you want to have a chat on like unpack what, you know, intimacy with God looks like. How do you actually build intimacy with God? You know, like for me, I actually created a WhatsApp chat group, and then, you know, with a friend, politely kicking him out. And then I just like, I'm just using this chat for some personal use. So I have a chat, you know, like how the group chat and a personal chat looks the same in the WhatsApp app. And so like, I'll actually use the app and actually chat with Jesus. And that's how I built intimacy. And so I think in this day and age where technology is a tool, but a distraction at the same time, how do you build intimacy with God, you know, to get through the, I'm not going to give up moments, but I'm about to give up, you know, like, you know, there is more that God is about to do. And there is more that God, I haven't seen God doing yet. Like, how do you build that intimacy? What do you do like in your busyness and stuff like that? Yeah.
Yeah. So I feel like intimacy is really coming really close to God and knowing his heart. It's one thing to know about somebody, and it's one thing to know somebody. And I think that's the difference with intimacy. Intimacy is no longer, I could know about you, but that doesn't mean that I have intimacy with you. But the minute I become intimate with you, I know you. And so I think it's many of us who, especially if we grew up in church, we may know about him. We know the stories about him. We know Jonah. We know David. We know the verses. We know the pictures. We know the maps. We know John 3:16. And a lot of that, sometimes we think, therefore I know him. But actually we don't. We only know about him. And I'm not saying that's a bad place, because that's maybe a place we need to be at awareness. But that cannot be the place that we stay at. And so intimacy is always an invitation to come deeper. And the beautiful thing about intimacy, it might sound like it's me actively pursuing, but I want to say it's actually also the Lord actively wooing you in. So it's not this like, how do I beat myself to be able to pursue the Lord? But the Bible says the Lord woo us in. He draws us close. And so as he draws us in, will we say yes to the invitation to intimacy? And sometimes the invitation cards doesn't look like the most pretty thing, like, oh, come and join me. Sometimes the invitation might be in a really bad or terrible place, and the Lord is actually asking you, come. In the worst and the most painful suffering of your life, I am found. In the valley, I am found. On the hill, I'm found. In the wildest, in the silence or in the loudness, I am all there. And he's every single day inviting us into intimacy. What would your yes be? And so for you, you decide, I'm going to do a WhatsApp group chat. And that might evolve. That may never be like that forever. It might be here for a season, and then something else is going to come your way. For me, my intimacy is to go to Bedok Reservoir, sit under a pull-up bar, and I'm praying and worshiping. And there are some people that you can't do it for hours. There's some people that can pray for hours. I'm just one that I can't. I would pray for like 5 minutes, and then I'll get really distracted. I'll be like, hey, there's an eagle. Hey, there's an ant. Hey, there's a bird. Hey, there's a... And sometimes you feel really lousy about ourselves, because we go, hey, is something wrong with me that I don't desire God enough? And the devil loves to use guilt and shame to distract us. And then we go, I guess I'm far away from God and I should just stay that way. But I don't. I decide, you know what? Even if I can just give a minute or 5 minutes, it's not about the time though. You know, especially Singaporeans are all about that. Okay, so how many minutes? Okay, how many this, blah, blah, blah. But it's not. It's just about, okay, I'm going to give my 5 minutes. And then if I need to do a workout, I do pull-ups. And then I'm going to go back into it. And just having that real time and intimacy and conversation with the Lord. So here's what I think and why I think that's important. One thing to know about him, and one thing to really know him. You know, when we give our lives to the Lord, right, he says that we are his bride, right? The church is his bride, and he's the bride, and he's coming back again. And if you think about it, you know what's interesting? What's interesting, if today, you know, you go get married, right? Or the people watching, right? You go get married. And when you get married, you get engaged, okay? You would notice, right, the bride will non-stop talk about her wedding day, right? If she got engagement ring, she will like wash the clothes, and then she'll low-key try to show off, like, oh, look at my ring, right? Then when she coughs, she'll like, like, you just want to show everybody the engagement ring, right? Even when she eats, she's so conscious constantly, right? I can't eat too much. If not, I cannot fit in my wedding dress. I can't eat too much. If not, I'll look a certain way. But on her mind is always the wedding day. And the thing is, when Jesus went away, and in the Jewish tradition, what's going to happen, right? What happens is that the bride or the when they're going to have their wedding, after they've been engaged, the bride and the groom, they kind of go their separate ways to prepare themselves for the wedding day. And then the groom gives the bride a gift to remind her that I'm coming back again. And so when we are related to this in the tradition, what the Lord is saying, when Jesus went away, he says, I'm coming back again. And he gives us a gift, and that's the Holy Spirit, to remind us of our commitment with him. But what is strange is we seem to need to be forced to talk about our engagement ring. We seem to be need to be forced to talk about relationship. So we need to come up with programs. All right, this is the 101 ways to evangelize. All right, this is the program you should be on. The program. Wouldn't it be so strange that a groom had to go and tell his wife, hey, you try to talk more about the wedding, eh? Okay, I tell you what, I give you 5 steps how to talk more about the wedding. Hey, please, I remind you, how come you never talk about the wedding today? Then you got to ask yourself, is there intimacy in the relationship? Or is this obligation or fear? And I think it's important for us to step into that place of intimacy. And so I ask myself that as well. I go, wow, do I really know him, or do I just know about him? And this is not to guilt trip anybody, because let me just say this, guilt will not get you anywhere. It will get you through tonight, and maybe the next 5 minutes you want to open your Bible. What is the most powerful one that will draw us in is love. That we have a God who loves us so much, that sends his son to die on the cross, and he loves us so much, he adores his bride. He says, I'm coming back again. And he's given us the Holy Spirit, who serves as a comforter and will share the secret things of the Lord's heart, and also to remind us of the commitment that we have made. And I think as the Lord continues to author and perfect our faith, not just ourselves, but he does it, the author and the perfecter of our faith, we continue to step and say, Lord, how do I say to your yes? How do I say yes to your everyday invitation to greater and deeper intimacy, so that we can be the bride that we're called to be? That I'm not forced, I'm not obligated, it's not a program, it's not once a week, it's not me writing out all my names and going, cell leader, check, am I okay? Come on. At some point, it gotta go deeper than that.
Yeah.
You know, and the Bible says, at some point, you gotta grow from milk to meat. Right? And it's okay if you're doing that for discipline in the beginning, that's okay. But at some point, you know, some people have done this for a long time and it begins to wear off and they go, I'm just sick of religion. I'm just sick of the obligation. I'm just sick of the church. And I say, well, before you talk about the church and anybody else, why not? Let's read the Bible, look in the mirror, ask and reflect on your own heart and go, Lord, bring me to deeper intimacy with you where I just don't know about you, but I know you.
Yeah, so good. I always use this example because, like, you know that there is a, we all know that there is an industry around worship. I mean, both of us are in worship ministry, and we know that it's very dangerous because the platform will kill us if we don't know how to handle the glory. Like, not the glory in a sense, but we don't know how to handle the responsibility, because the moment we misuse God's glory, we know what happens. We see that in the Old Testament, we get struck down. And so, like, recently God's been, like, you know, just challenging me, like, you know, not just me, but also, like, to be an example of, you know, we should be loving the person of Jesus and not, you know, like, loving the idea of Jesus, because everyone wants the blessing. And the moment we get the blessing, we just throw away, you know, like the blessed, like, oh, okay, yeah, I got the blessing. I'll need you when I need you. And it just seems like Jesus is a vending machine, and that's really not intimacy at all.
Yeah.
And okay, 8:45, you maybe one or two more questions, and so I can let you go because you have another meeting. Don't want to dry your throat. Looking at my script here,
because
I'm a camera shy person, so I really need, you know, like, things
don't look like it at all. You're doing phenomenal.
Thank you. Yeah, so we talk about, okay, so let's bring it close to home, like intimacy during this COVID-19 season. What you know, like, What God is in your intimacy with God, when you're spending time with God, what do you think God is actually teaching us, or wanting us to learn in this season?
Mm. You know, I feel like there are many things that the Lord is doing, but I do think that COVID has presented a really amazing opportunity for us to ask ourselves this: am I just faithful because there are programs in place? Am I just faithful because church is in place? What happens when the organized religion part of it becomes on a pause? Does your faith also pause? Does your faith rise and fall with activity and programs? And these activity and programs are supposed to help, but has the very thing that is supposed to be the thing that enables you to have become a closer walk with God become your crutch? That without it, you can't walk. That without it, you cannot pursue and seek. And so I feel like what COVID has done has put us all in this place of really asking and really reflecting. And a lot of times in your idleness, your real idols will be revealed. I read this in an article on Thirst. It says, in the idleness, I-D-L-E, your idols, I-D-O-Ls, will be revealed. And I feel that that's really true. And so what COVID has done, and I think it's revealed a lot of things that's really hidden in our hearts. And some says, right, let thy words, Lord, your word of God, let it be the treasured and stored in my heart, and it be hidden in my heart. And we have to ask ourselves, like, what is hidden in our hearts? And I think COVID has kind of revealed for some of us, perhaps, what is hidden in our hearts. And if you have gone through this space and time where you feel like, oh, it's revealed that I'm lazy, you know, I'm just gaming all the time, I'm just doing things I shouldn't be doing, you know, don't just be discouraged. But would that draw you to be a place of like, okay, Lord, thank you for revealing these things. Now I want to come repentant. And I says, Lord, would you continue to mold my heart? I think this is an invitation, a deep invitation, where the Lord is wooing his people. And in Hosea, there's a verse, I think in chapter 2, it says, right, that he woos us into the wilderness to speak comfort to us. And I think we're entering almost into a wilderness where the Lord will speak comfort to us. And I pray, don't waste this moment and those opportunity. Don't waste what the Lord is able to do in such a circumstance and dare to go into the place and to seek his heart. I just give this simple analogy. It's kind of like this analogy of, you know, if a parent is unhappy with a child, it says, I want you to go to the room and I want you to think about your actions, right? I want you to go to the room. And so the kid goes into the room, closes the door, and it says, the father says, okay, I ground you about 5-6 hours. Okay, you stay in your room and you reflect. For most kids, you know that they're not going to reflect, right? If they have their phone, they'll be like, I got my phone, it doesn't matter, I'm just going to waste these 5 hours away. And the 5 hours pass and the kid walks out and go, whatever, you didn't really do anything to me, you know? And he walks out not any better than when he came in. And what I believe the Lord is doing is not the Lord is punishing us, I'm not saying that, but I think the Lord has sent us to our rooms to reflect. Well, we all have to be in our own space. The top leaders and pastors and all that has to be in a quiet space of their own rooms, a lot of more intimate space. And the question is, will we just go, let me just wait until everything goes back to normal? And will we play with our phones, use our computers, do all these different things? Then we walk out of this whole lockdown, we walk out of all these circuit breaker things, we walk out of all these like room moments, just walking out the same as before, even worse, just 6 more hours of gaming, 3 months more of doing something else. Right. Or will we say, you know what, Lord, what are you doing in this moment and hour? What is truly on your heart? And Lord, will you reveal that to me so that we walk out and not miss the point of all that's going on right now, and that we can catch his heart and the intimacy that he's wooing us and inviting us into? Yeah.
Love that. So we'll wrap up.
Okay.
What's the one thing you have in your heart this season that you want to encourage our friends and people out there with?
I feel like, you know, Isaiah chapter 60 talks about how darkness will cover the earth, right? Let me do a time for a Bible moment.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, here we go. Isaiah 60. So let me read to you. Everybody, this is not a quiet time, okay? So if you go like, I watch this live, so I'm done with my quiet moments, so I can, then you've lost. Okay, anyway, Isaiah chapter 60 says this: arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness with the people. But the Lord will rise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. And this verse talks about how darkness covers the earth, right? And we look at the world, society, and we see that the world is getting more dark, right? We're getting into more terrible times. And the Bible even calls it in the last days of the end times, right? People will become lovers of themselves. There will be idolatry and adultery and all these things. And sometimes for us as Christians, it feels very hopeless. Like the world is getting worse. So should I do anything? Anyway, the Bible says, right? It's kind of, the world's not going to become a better place. But you see, the verse after it says that the darkness shall cover the earth and deep darkness the people. But it says, but the Lord will rise over you and his glory will be seen upon you. Which means as the darkness increases, the glory of his church and his bride, and by church and bride, I'm not talking about the building, I'm talking about the people. As the darkness increases, the glory of his church and his bride will also increase because his glory will be over us and people will see it. So I believe in the darkest moments, we will see the most glorious church that we've ever seen before. And when you think about what the most glorious church is, I'm telling you, it's not more light. It's not more sound. It's not more smoke machine. It's not more LED screens. It's not bigger gatherings. It may be, I don't know. But what I'm saying, the glorious church would be this, a church of truth, a people that knows their truth. And so the glory of the church is not found in its output, of its beauty, of its design, its artistry, its creativity. The glory of the church is in a time where there is so much lies, deception, half-truths, fake news, cancel culture, non-stop. You will see a group of people that will rise, daring to speak truth, and that will be the glorious church. And so I encourage you, as we go into the darkest times of history, and COVID alone, a lot of people have said this is unprecedented. We are about to enter one of the worst times. Let me tell you, people who are Christian and children of God, as darkness, deep darkness, the people, darkness cover the earth, but the Lord will rise over you and his glory will be seen upon you.
Yeah.
Know your truth. Read and meditate on the word of God day and night. Let it be stored in your heart so that you would be able to be the glorious church that God is calling you to be. Not just looking greater, not just more follows on the account, not just greater videos. All of that is great expressions, but it needs to come from the first core fundamental of truth, and that is Jesus Christ. Truth are not concepts. Truth is a person, and his name is Jesus. So get to know truth, and we will see the church become absolutely glorious.
Love that. Love that. Well, you know what? You want to give an altar call tonight? So good. Isaac, really, thanks, buddy, for, you know, coming on live tonight to really share. I think a lot of people are blessed from the comments that I've been reading as well. And so, really, so grateful for this new reconnection and friendship. And, yeah, some people are saying, like, oh, let's do episode two.
Anytime. My joy, dude. Anytime. Thanks for coming on. Thanks for inviting me to share a little bit. I'm really excited to see what the Lord is doing. It's always great to be able to talk to other people who also have a heart for God, heart for people, heart to go. How can we bring his glory? So it's a great blessing, dude. It's great to reconnect with you for sure, 100%. Let me know if you need anything else.
Cool. Cool beans. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks, everyone.